the name of God, the Most Merciful, Most Compassionate, Your Highness Sheikh Tamim Mohammed Al Thani, the Emir of the State of Qatar, Your Excellency Sheikh Abdullah bin Nasser bin Khalifa Al Thani, Prime Minister, Minister of the Interior, Your Excellencies, Ministers, dear guests, may the blessings of Allah be upon you all. We welcome you to the opening session of the Gulf Studies Forum, which this year will deal with two main topics. The first will be focusing its attention on the educational system in the Gulf GCC countries and their attempt to turn into a knowledge-based economy. And secondly, the outside threats and challenges. And when it comes to education, I'm sure we are all aware of the importance of education, and Gulf countries, like other countries, are aware of that since their independence, and attempts have been made extensively to improve the education system, which was accompanied by the growth in the economy and the growth in the population, so much so that the educational system can be brought up to into the standards that fulfill the needs of countries like UAE, Bahrain, and Qatar, and more specific educational plans and strategies have been set forth and implemented, and new free zones, educational free zones, and educational cities have been established, and campuses for foreign universities have been established, and reforming and improving the educational system, especially in higher education, has been focused on to respond to the huge exponential growth in the population. Many investments have been made, and in addition to sending students to study abroad on scholarships and grants. But nonetheless, formidable challenges are still present. For this reason, the Gulf Studies Forum has organized this event to which experts from the area and outside it have been invited to share thoughts and ideas as to how best to respond to these challenges. So our thanks go to the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies. And on this occasion, I invite His Excellency Sheikh Suhaim Al Thani to deliver a speech on behalf of the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies. In the name of God, the Most Merciful, Most Compassionate, Your Highness, Sheikh Hamad bin Tamim Al Thani, the Emir of Kuwait, Your Excellencies, the Ministers, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, on behalf of the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies, it's my pleasure to extend our welcome to the opening ceremony of the Gulf Studies Forum. The success with which the last session was met, to which a large number of experts from Gulf and Arab countries were invited, and the very useful exchange of ideas has turned this forum into a permanent feature in the life of the Gulf as GCC countries. In the first year of the forum, we are going to discuss the cooperation within the GCC countries as an internal issue, and secondly, the regional and international challenges faced by the Gulf countries, which will be a permanent feature on the agenda of the years to come of the workings of this forum. All in all, we have received no less than 160 proposals on both themes, and the panel of judges and experts have approved 55 research papers. This forum is part and parcel of the annual conferences that the center organizes with the peer-reviewed papers, and I would like to avail myself of this opportunity to introduce to you the idea of or the plan of what we intend to do at the center, and headed the list is headed by the Conference on Scientific Research, and the next conference will be held in March, and during that conference, the annual award for the rewards awarded by the center will be announced, and the center has also organized other symposia, like the relationships between the Arabs and Russia, the Arabs and Turkey, the Arabs and the West. And next May, we will organize an event on the relations between the Arabs and China, in which we hope to discuss relative issues. And also in the last 2 months, other events were organized, like the Russian intervention in Syria and the future of the Palestinian National Project and the situation in Yemen. These are all scientific conferences based on scientific methodology and peer-reviewed papers, to which also experts from all walks of life are invited, where academicians discuss with politicians and other experts the kind of topics which are relevant to our area and the region and the world. And the experts from Gulf countries will contribute with their expertise. Your Highness, ladies and gentlemen, we cannot focus on GCC issues in isolation from each other, but as a one unified system, and this will enrich our discussion further and will turn our discussion into a more fruitful discussion between the intellectual elite of the area. The Arab Center hopes that this forum will be truly a Gulf forum and a framework for scientific research and objective discussion and debate, and hopefully eventually will contribute to our culture and enable our countries to keep up with developments. The center will soon move to the Doha Center of Higher Research and Studies, which was inaugurated in October of this year. And this is an independent academic institution dealing with humanities, arts, and social sciences, and has enjoyed the support of His Highness the Emir Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani. And the center, of course, and in this context, has other projects like the historical dictionary and which contains vocabulary from the last 2,000 years, and a group of distinguished linguists and specialists are working on, and the volumes will be printed over a period of the next 15 years. The center has also adopted other programs to facilitate what Arab researchers do, like for visiting researchers and grants for research. And some of these are open to all Arab researchers. And the center is also linked with other scientific institutions through memoranda of understandings. In addition to this side of its work, the center works on analyzing events and ideas in the Arab world and produce political analyses of the events in the area and brainstorming sessions, and publishes a number of journals like Tabayyun and Umran and Siyasat Arabiya and Stool Dirasat Tarikhiya, and the first annual book will be published towards the end of this year. The center is also working on issuing two journals. The center will also has a center of translation, which translates reference books and textbooks from different languages into Arabic, in the hope of contributing to the cultural exchange and interaction with the other cultures. In this context, in the publishing department of the center publishes many books each year after being peer-reviewed, and we have published more than 141 books so far, which has been a major contribution and extension to the Arabic library. And also we have a survey which conducts a program of research and survey into the trends in public opinion. Finally, it's my pleasure to express on behalf of the center our deep thanks and appreciations to the state of Qatar for hosting this center. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Sheikh Suhaim, for delivering the speech of the Arab Center. Your Highness the Emir, Your Excellency the Prime Minister, distinguished guests. The Arab Center for Research, Policy and Study is trying to keep up with the world's studies, researchers, and publications that tackle issues all over the world. And the Doha Institute for Higher Studies was established in this context. It has attracted a lot of students from Doha and abroad in order to be the basis of any advanced society. Dr. Hend Al Muftah, Deputy President of the Institute, please, the floor is yours. In the name of God, most gracious, most merciful, Your Highness the Emir Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani, Emir of the State of Qatar, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum. the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies honored me by allowing to deliver this address, the opening of the Gulf Studies Forum, and we would like this forum to be the gathering for all academics and all researchers in order to exchange ideas about the situation in our countries scientifically. I would like to deliver a presentation about the foundation of a promising institute that is the Institute of Higher Studies that was opened after 2 months of studies and effort delivered for more than 4 years in order to establish this institute and transform this unique idea from a dream to reality that brings together all the members of the education system. Based on the vision of Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies that hopes to contribute positively at the level of the social sciences and public administration and boosting the education and higher education all over the Arab world as part of an Arab vision and identity that is open, and the need to prepare a new generation of enlightened Arab youth with a critical mind and with a big knowledge when it comes to the social sciences and the policies. And they would be at the service of the state of Qatar and the Arab world. This is how the idea of the institute was born. And some of the special fields of specialization were marginalized in the past, and we try to highlight the importance of these master's degrees based on a very well studied foundation that allows the students to study in different areas. The vision of the Higher Institute or Institute of Higher Studies is to develop the social sciences, the development economies, and sustainability, and the integration of education and researchers allows us to create academics and professionals capable of being professional and holding the standards and keeping up with the standards. They would be the leaders of the future, and they would be capable of boosting human knowledge and responding to our needs for advancement and progress. The turning point was when the institute was supported by His Highness the Emir Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani, was still heir apparent. He saw this institute as part of the vision of Qatar in order to develop the human capital and the identity of the state of Qatar based on the vision that he had about the importance of the elite in the Arab world and the contribution to the development of this part of the world. It began as a consultative committee that was led by Dr. Azmi Bishara, and efforts were deployed in order to prepare for this promising project with criteria developed, and the curricula was developed in 2011 or 13. The main directions and points were developed which helped the team of this project to start working on the foundation of this institute by working directly on the administration and the organization of this institute. And the efforts continued until the end of 2013, when the first board of trustees was founded and established. And the design was in line with the vision, and it is the work is undergoing and is ongoing, and it will be delivered by the end of 2016. The effort continued in 2014. The institute was about to see light, especially with the establishment of the different administrative cadre and with a direct supervision and oversight by the head of the board of trustees. In 2014, in May, it was licensed, and the cooperation was established with renowned institutes all over the world, believed in the vision of this institute, and work on the administration continued. And as a result, we are now capable of receiving the first generation of students, and I would like to invite you to visit the institute. And for academic year 2015-2016, there were nine master's program. So you have social sciences, philosophy, history, literature, public administration, and sustainability economies, and or development economies. We will also coordinate with the Committee of Higher Education, and would like to thank them for their cooperation. The first generation of students were received, and the institute attracted the best student in the world by reviewing their by reviewing their files, and they represent a huge diversity from all over the world. Then they will interact and build these bonds among each other, and they would benefit from this experience that is unprecedented in the Arab world. The Doha Center for Higher Studies, or the Doha Institute for Higher Studies, is in line with the vision of Qatar. The vision for the future was built under National Vision 2030. By 2030, Qatar is to become an advanced country capable of achieving sustainability or sustainable development in light of the national strategies and plans to implement these strategies. The economic development and the human resources of the countries and the natural resources of the country are the core of this development. The investment in the human capital lays the foundation of this sustainable development. Our wise leadership believes that there is no identity if we do not belong to bigger circles, and Qatar is a main part of the Gulf, of the Arab world, and of the Islamic world, and also the international community. This is how the dream became reality, thanks to our leadership. The institute was launched as a development project that triggers excellency and tackles topics that were marginalized in our area, and it encourages the youth to carry on at this level. So the human sciences allow them to bond with different cultures and feelings of friendship toward different cultures. The vision of the institute was to fill the gap because that was created because of bad curricula, and that there was a wrong idea in our society about the fact that social sciences were not needed, and we tried to change that. This institute contributes to the knowledge all over the world, and boosting the research in Arabic. Arabic was used in order to do the researchers with other supporting languages like English and other languages. These students will have the opportunity to benefit from a faculty that is renowned and that has got high expertise in a university environment that provides the freedom and the independence of thought that triggers new ideas and that makes them creative and innovative. They are at the core of this project to develop the human capital particularly the Qatari human being and the Arab human being, and it is part of the Gulf institutions as a result of clear policies that take into account the needs of our society. There's also work on the master's degrees, and the institute currently provides the vocational training for different administrations in Qatar, from the public sector, training and workshop were started by the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies and then referred to the institute. We are sure that this institute will be a key center in the Arab world, and the graduates from this institute will become the leaders of the Arab world. And we look forward to seeing this institute contributing to the important studies that would raise the name of Qatar and the Arab world and contribute to the production in Arabic all over the world. In the end, I would like to thank once again His Highness the Emir for his support, and I would like to thank all the people who deployed efforts in order to create this institute, notably Dr. Azmi Bishara, the head of Board of Trustees, and the faculty and the employees who believed in the vision of this institute, and to all the efforts that were deployed. And I would like to end by quoting His Highness the Emir when he talked about the most important challenges that Qatar is facing. He said that we are still facing the challenge of development. First and foremost, the development of human being. Human beings are our wealth. And we all hope, Your Highness, that Doha or the institute, this institute will be in line with this vision. It will be this lighthouse of culture and science and contributor to the social development, not only in Qatar, but also all over the Arab world. And it is also in line with the leading role of our country that takes into account the human capital in Qatar and all over the Arab world. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hend, for delivering your speech, Your Excellency, Your Highness, Your Excellency, ladies and gentlemen. Qatar has paid a lot of attention to reforming education and the renaissance that has been experiencing from kindergarten level to university level has been momentous, yet the challenges are still there. We have with us now Dr. Mohammed Abdul Wahid Al Hammadi, Minister of Education and Higher Education. He served as many universities in Qatar. He was Dean of the College of Engineering and Vice President for Planning and Institutional Development. Now the floor is yours, Your Excellency. In the name of God, most merciful, most compassionate, may all praise be to Allah, Lord of the universe, and the blessings of Allah be upon His Messenger, Your Highness Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani, Your Excellency Prime Minister, distinguished guests, may the blessings of Allah be upon you all. Please allow me at the outset to convey to His Highness the Emir Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani our greatest gratitude, first of all, for honoring us with his gracious attending and his full support of our forum and the issues we discuss. There is no doubt that his instructions and the instructions of their majesties and highnesses, the rulers of the GCC countries, play a major role in achieving the kind of aspirations as peoples of the GCC countries aspire to in education and other fields of life. It's also my pleasure to thank the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies for participating in this forum, which is being held under the auspices of His Highness the Emir. It's no doubt that choosing education and the regional challenges for this year's forum is very appropriate indeed, especially in view of the fact that education will be the focus of much of the attention in the forum. And as you know, education has stronger presence than many other issues on the agenda of the GCC countries, and our governments have worked hard to provide education for our communities since the early days of independence, and have always considered education as part and parcel of the attempts towards the development and advancement of our countries. For this reason, many educational programs have been established in order to create the kind of transformation of the educational system, whether to do with the inputs or the outputs of education. Investment in education and the involvement of the private sector was also present, and this emanates from the belief of our governments that education is a pillar for sustainable development. In addition to all of this, a lot of attention has been given to increasing the number of students and tackling the problem of truancy and trying to fulfill the needs of the job market through better educational outputs. In addition to all of this, GCC countries have adopted the kind of policies which are compatible to this line of thinking and have invited foreign universities to establish branches in their countries and start educational cities. And we can also notice that the educational systems in GCC countries are quite similar, and this is due to Gulf countries are always trying to provide free education for their citizens and other educational systems without any taxation or fees. This requires us now to critically examine this kind of policies, and maybe our forum can be a step forward on this path. Ladies and gentlemen, the leaders of the GCC countries, through their decisions, through the GCC, have always indicated the huge importance they allow to education and to treat the students as students who are studying at the expense of their governments, accrediting their certificates and documentation. And they have also allowed the citizens of other GCC countries to get equal working opportunities and study at each other's universities and other forms of collaboration. They have also adopted similar standards when it comes to accrediting different educational certificates, and also the Gulf Network for Quality Assurance in Education was established. On top of that, many other joint projects and endeavors have come to light over the years, and this included a number of programs which are accompanied by performance measuring indicators in order to fulfill the directives and instructions of the leaders of the community of the GCC, and to enhance cooperation and collaboration between them and help better prepare our youth for what the future holds through expanding their knowledge, enhancing their values and skills. Educational systems in GCC countries, like similar ones in other countries, and despite this huge amount of support, they still face some formidable challenges which hinder achieving the improvement we aspire to. And despite the huge expenses and large amounts of money spent on the educational system, tests like TIMSS and PISA show that our outputs are still below standard, and also the increased dependence on teachers from outside the Gulf area weakens the patriotic feeling among students, and in comparison to the huge costs, and also the weakness and the level of performance by teachers and the teaching staff, despite the huge advancements in technology, yet utilizing technology in order to enhance the educational system and teaching courses is yet to achieve the desired goals. In addition, the kind of inferior look to this kind of education is still present, and the weakness in the partnership between the family unit and the school, despite all efforts made, and the presence of a huge gap between the outputs of the educational system and the needs of the job market, and also private tuition has grown tremendously, and also the negative way our culture has been exposed to outside culture and the weakness of the Arabic language. Naturally, these are not specific to Gulf areas, but the entire Arab world suffers from that. And if we focus on our young country, Qatar, we will find that Qatar has made it a main pillar of its National Vision 2030 to develop the human capital and the educational system. This system provides the opportunity for our citizens to enable them and empower them to achieve the kind of success they personally aspire to, and fulfills the needs of the country and their contribution to the national economy in a manner which strengthens the social fabric of society and achieves stronger interaction with other countries and cultures. For this reason, the 2011 to 2016 strategy, national strategy, has been set forth, and it includes first enhancing the national identity and the values of Qatari society and Arab and Islamic values and include them in the educational system and curricula. And also, secondly, to improve education and implement quality assurance standards and provide the teachers and the teaching staff with the necessary skills and enhance the participation of other sectors in society and the educational system. Number three, improve higher education through providing alternative paths to higher education to achieve a knowledge-based economy. Number four, try to create a balance between the technical studies and the academic and professional qualification. Number five, encourage scientific innovation. These and other projects emanate from the belief that the role of education is not on the pedagogical side only, but to contribute to a knowledge-based society, stronger family structures, because education interacts with all other aspects of life and creates a kind of citizen who can take the right decisions when it comes to family issues, health issues, and social issues. Education also can contribute to innovation in engineering, medicine, technology, and hence reading the role of the educational system from this perspective and based on the National Strategy 2011-2016 will make us realize that Qatar has achieved a good positioning and good rating at the Arab countries and at the level of elementary schools and intermediate and secondary schools. And also when it comes to the managing schools and providing internet connection to schools, this huge achievement and the high ranking that Qatar has achieved among other countries could not have been possible without the help and support of our political leader headed by His Highness the Emir Sheikh Tamim Mohammed Al Thani and the directives of His Excellency the Prime Minister and the chairperson of the Supreme Council for Education, and also the close follow-up activities of all aspects of the educational system. If we move to higher education, we will find that it's much similar in GCSE countries. We still are faced with challenges like governance and reaching a complete system of safeguarding and quality assurance, and also the way higher education institutions work and organize, in addition to dealing with indices, data on higher education. This kind of system, once it's established, it will facilitate better integration with other GCC countries for the benefit of all. Also, amongst the other challenges faced by education and higher education in Gulf countries and other Arab countries is the poor outputs of the educational system and also the poor quality of secondary education and the lack of success that they can achieve later on when joining universities and following different paths, benefiting from the huge advances in technology and the expansion of the programs based on the Arabic language. In addition, the provision of easily organized data and information will be an important tool to implement the kind of policies, but the educational system lacks a central database now, and as a consequence of that, it's difficult to take decisions at the national or regional level. Ladies and gentlemen, we in the state of Qatar, when we try to keep in line with the latest advancements in technology and the achievements in other countries and the exchange of documents between the different institutions relative to the educational system, are working on providing a unified electronic database which will enable all stakeholders to benefit from and aid them in making their decisions. The GCC countries have embarked on this project to better link the GCC countries and in a manner which will enable their member states to benefit from joint research projects. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no doubt that funding higher education institutions and government spending on these institutions requires a closer look in view of the poor results and the number of graduates. And this is an indication that financial resources have not been well spent in this regard, and they are good indicators of the influence and activity of any institution and to the necessity to provide funding from other sources than the state and to realize whether or not these kind of institutions serve the interests of the GCC countries or not. In addition to all of that, some private institutions can increase the rate of absorption of students and create more flexibility in fulfilling the needs of the job market in this state. Therefore, it can be of more benefit to encourage the private sector and also to send the students on scholarships at the expense of the private sector to open more opportunities and investment in the educational system. Your Highness the Emir, Your Excellency the Prime Minister, we look forward to this kind of event to provide this comprehensive look at the educational sector and achieve better cooperation understanding through enhancing the investment opportunities in our educational systems and provide joint tools to measure performance and quality assurance and expansion in the role of private universities to serve the children of the expat community, in addition to better using and utilizing the Arabic language. We pray to Almighty God to grant us success in our endeavors, and may the blessings of Allah be upon you all.
Thank you, Dr. Mohammed Al Hammadi, Minister of Education, Higher Education. Your Highness, the Emir, Your Excellency, the Prime Minister, esteemed guests, the cooperation council of the Gulf, despite all the challenges, is still the only cooperation that's still available after 35 years of turmoil in the region, starting with the Iranian-Iraqi war and then the invasion of Kuwait, the U.S. invasion of Iraq and its repercussions, and our today's violence that we witness in the region. About that, the former Secretary General of the GCC, Mr. Abdullah Bishara, will be talking to us. He's a Kuwaiti diplomat and statesman. Bishara was the first Secretary General of the Gulf Cooperation Council from 1981-1993. He was the ambassador of Kuwait to the United Nations from 1971 to 1981. He is currently the president of the Diplomatic Center for Strategic Studies and a regular columnist, lecturer on diplomacy and strategy. The floor is yours. In the name of God, the most gracious, most merciful, Your Highness, the Emir Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani, Your Excellency, the Prime Minister, ladies and gentlemen, it is a great honor for me to talk to you very briefly about the map of the responsibilities that the leaders of the GCC set during the Abu Dhabi summit in 1981. And I would like to tell you about an experience that I had firsthand, where I followed up the efforts deployed by the leaders in order to translate this roadmap. Leaders of the Gulf decided to create the Gulf Cooperation Council in order to face the dangers and challenges unified, in order to limit these threats and deal with them with the Gulf wisdom, and that is based on consultations and wisdom, in order to strengthen the region and protect it from the adventure of the people who are reckless in their decisions. The leaders of the Gulf Cooperation Council wanted to protect their own countries and the GCC as a whole. Personally, I didn't imagine at the beginning that the foundation of the GCC in May 1985 would make this GCC or the Council responsible or have huge responsibilities when it comes to security and stability at a regional level in the Arab world and internationally. There was a lot of burdens. The leaders of the GCC talked of or discussed them during Abu Dhabi summit. First of all, they wanted to stop the Iranian-Iraqi war, supported by the Arabs and the world, in order to prevent this war from reaching the Gulf and maintaining the balance of power, and resisting the attempts to change the regional system and creating a unified Arab position, raising awareness of the world to the efforts of the GCC, and exerting pressure on both sides to stop fighting. In addition to that, facing Iran that wanted to create a Gulf radicalism that supports it within the GCC countries. It was the paper of burdens that was born after Abu Dhabi summit in 1981. The leaders of the Gulf had a lot or had the best interests of the Gulf at heart, and they wanted to preserve the borders of the Gulf that was kept since the First World War, and they wanted to strengthen the pride of the people of the Gulf and to respect the international legitimacy. And the leaders of the Gulf were aware that the strength of Gulf countries is based on interaction between government and people. The birth of the council was at the Arab level. It attempted to create these relationships between the Arab countries with respect of sovereignties of Arab countries, with no interference, and it aimed at creating a Gulf-Arab partnership based on political, economic, and cultural understanding in an environment of friendliness. The Gulf Cooperation Council took these measures or the necessary measures in order to stop the war by convincing Tehran and Baghdad about the uselessness of war, and both sides were warned not to attack the sources of oil that is the foundation of stability in the world. There was a lot of challenges faced by the Cooperation Council. Despite these challenges, the GCC worked in order to overcome the problem, deployed all possible efforts in order to achieve the vision and objectives. Amid the hostile environment between the Ba'athist regime of Iraq and the revolution in Iran, and the hostility between the Ba'ath of Iraq and the Ba'ath of Syria, and the presence of Arab parties against Egypt after the peace agreement with Israel, and Iran was attempting to spread sectarianism, and it did away with the international legitimacy, and there was no hope of a solution for a solution of the Palestinian cause. There was a lot of challenges that the GCC had to face. The GCC had this burden from 1981 to 1991, where he was, or it was capable of halting the threats of Iran. It supported the Iraqi sovereignty, and it gained international support. It supported Iraq by attempting to stop the violence. And GCC could liberate Kuwait from the Iraqi invasion. And 10 years later, the GCC guaranteed the sovereignty of the Gulf and the independence of its countries. There were four topics that are vital when it comes to the diplomacy of the GCC. And today, we can still see that. First of all, the file of energy, terrorism and sectarianism, dialogue with Iran, and the future of the Arab world. When it comes to the energy dossier, let me tell you about my personal experience with the Gulf oil producing countries after the October war in 1973 and the embargo that was imposed. When it comes to the export of oil, I have lived firsthand the lack of trust during the discussions at the United Nations, and I have witnessed the fear that the poor people of the developing countries felt, and I felt that the West, led by the United States of America, wanted to adopt an oil strategy that is based on energy outside of the Gulf oil countries, based on modern technology and the seeking alternatives and digging for renewable energy sources. However, the Gulf international cooperation highly contributes to the stability of this world based on several facts, particularly energy. Very few countries have these sources of energy that is needed by many. There is no prosperity without energy, and there is no stability without energy. The Gulf countries have provided the tyranny of scarcity. So the tyranny of scarcity, I studied this concept during the energy crisis in 1973, especially after President Al-Huwai became President of Algeria in March 1970s. He went to the United Nations and I was there, and he opened the topic of the international economy that is oppressing developing countries and supports the developed countries. I have felt back then that oil has given the Gulf countries the aura of power, and the Gulf countries had secured a very important position in these consultations, and it had raised the ranking at the political level of the Gulf countries. Today's situation is different than what I have seen in the past, and what we got used to, this prestigious strategic ranking all over the world, because modern technology has provided shale oil that has very reasonable prices with this development. The shale oil has formed a huge challenge to the oil producing Gulf countries. The glow of these resources should not fade, because it has huge consequences internally at the Arab level and internationally, whether we're talking about the political level, the economic level, and the development level. The United Gulf position is needed in order to talk within OPEC, with our partners within OPEC or outside of OPEC. Two. Terrorism is the beast that the Gulf and the world face. The remedy to terrorism starts with the contribution to this international alliance, and continues with the strength and stability of the system within each country, the support of the people, dialogue, and the participation of all parties at the political level. And this would give the people and the youth hope, and people would be supporting each other within countries and would face any terrorists that are attempting to attack the Gulf system. We have talked about the importance of reviewing the education system, the importance of citizenship, equal citizenship, doing away with sectarianism, and focusing on the fact that Islam is the religion of moderation and of understanding. Your Highness, Your Excellencies, Your Highness, Your Excellencies, the dialogue with our neighboring countries was at the heart of the strategy of Abu Dhabi summit in 1981, especially with Iran, that adopts radical diplomacy that is unprecedented, that is in contradiction with the international behavior standards. The leaders of the Gulf during the 8th summit in Riyadh on the 26th of December 1987 decided to start a dialogue with Iran based on 10 principles inspired by the Charter of the League of Arab States and the United Nations and the rules of good neighborhood and building the trust. And these 10 points were delivered officially to Iran to lay the foundation of a future dialogue. However, Iran did not take this paper into account, did not study it seriously, because this paper is not in line, or was not in line, with the political discourse in Iran, and most of these policies in Iran talk about the halting or facing threats and dangers. Your Highness, Your Excellencies, it is clear that the Gulf Cooperation Council is laying the foundation of a new Arab system, and we see today the underlining legitimacy in Yemen and fighting sectarian terrorism. This unified system aims at laying the foundation of Arab regimes that have to be based on popular support and good governance. This new system reiterates the legitimacy of every Arab regime according to the internationally recognized borders and respecting the Arab world and doing away with interference within or interference in internal affairs, with an openness at the cultural and development level and investments, and creating relations based on understanding and respect. Your Highness, the Emir, in within days, the leaders will meet in Riyadh in order to tackle a very problematic issue. The leaders, based on the situation today, would most certainly renew the calling upon different parties to unify the position and face Iran and Iran's plan. The leaders of the Gulf will continue to talk about Islam, the moderate religion, and this is what the forefathers and the leaders of the GCC talked about during the foundation of the Council, protecting the Gulf from ideologies and from slogans that are not in line with the Arab identity and that creates more division. Your Highness, I am personally relieved because the Gulf Cooperation Council could indeed protect the security of the member states, and it also succeeded in creating an economic and development base at the Arab world that is based on moderation and based on openness. And I am personally at peace because I know that the Gulf countries know the importance of taking wise steps in order to move toward modern societies and countries. This is the hope of the youth and the people of the GCC. This is what they want to see as a result of the Riyadh summit. May the peace of God be with you all.
Thank you, Your Excellency Abdullah Bishara, for his insight on the challenges faced by the GCC countries Your Highness the Emir Sheikh Tamim Al Hamad Al Thani, Prime Minister, distinguished guests, we've come to the end of this opening session, and the forum will continue tomorrow and the day after. And finally, all that remains to be done is to express our gratitude to His Highness the Emir for honoring us with his attendance. Please, ladies and gentlemen, remain seated until His Highness and the Prime Minister leave the hall. Thank you.